So Bleach, the Thousand Year Blood War arc has finally come out. We have episode 1 and here is my review. So stick around and hear what I have to say. Or maybe not. It's up to you. You know, I ain't stopping you. So as you can imagine, I've watched this episode many of times over and discovered new things here and there. Now, I could sit down and really script out this video and tell you about every little single detail that I have found, but then again, that's not really a review, that's more so of a breakdown. So in terms of a review, I kind of just want to discuss what I really like and what I dislike and little things that I found cool essentially going out throughout the episode. And I'm definitely not going to give you an overview of telling you everything that happened in the episode. Go watch it and then come back here. Other than that, I will say that Taguchi's new style has really grown on me, as I expected from the trailers, going from many different art styles and from many different color palettes and I guess weather effects and different atmospheres really kind of alienated you as an old fan going to watch this series for the trailers, because you really don't know how to feel about the new style. But once you actually watch the episode and you get conditioned for more than 2 minutes on the environment that you're in, it really does start sinking in, and the environment doesn't really change until you like get throughout the day or get throughout the episode, which is good because it's very realistic. So like 1 minute you're in like a kind of dusk type thing with Ichigo versus Iburn, and then as the battle's going on, the sunset is lowered more and you get more of a red kind of sunset, which is great and really realistic. And again, I can't really stress enough how great the background artists and the color palette team have just been throughout this whole episode, because the one thing that I will say carried this episode the most, genuinely from my perception, and it's not to downplay anything else, was the background art. Because seeing Karakura Town, seeing just the different lightings and the surroundings, even when you got Yuki patrolling around Karakura Town and like landing and you see that garbage with all the crows picking at it, just little things like that, the street lamps and the lights and traffic lights really set this awesome tone. Even the building of which Chad destroyed, and yes, we will talk about that because it has definitely been a room for discussion about that scene in general, which I do find funny. So let's get into that. That's one thing, an aspect that I really enjoyed the most, and it really set the stage and the tone of the series, because that's what the Thousand Year Blood War arc is. It is a tone, it is a feeling of what you are about to get into. And from what I've seen from other people reacting to it as well, is that it really drives home of this isn't like kiddie stuff, this isn't daytime Mickey Mouse playground. See the Mickey Mouse reference there because of the Disney acquisition? Yeah, just thought I'd throw a funny joke in there. Either way, it's going to show you that this is a serious arc, and it does this quite beautifully actually. Yes, we do get some no-name soul reapers, which I will discuss further on, but I do want to notice this detail since we are talking about backgrounds, is that when Yuki is sitting on the bridge and kind of patrolling the area, you get multiple shots of not only the city but also the traffic lights. And this is important because it goes from green to amber to red, and you notice that as soon as it goes to red, that's when everything starts kicking off. So it's kind of displaying to you through showing these shots of the traffic lights, that it's showing you where we are at in terms of severity. So green, everything's calm, everything's good. Amber, there's a sinister feeling, and then the red with the traffic lights then gave like straight off the bat big hollow attack. So that was a good introduction. Talking of introductions, let's talk about the start of the episode, which is Yuha Baha speaking. We get an introduction of him talking about the Quincy King coming in after being resurrected after 900 years, regaining his intellect after 90, and regaining his strength after 9 years. This was a great way to start off the episode and really gave you a great example into the kind of villain that we're going to be getting into. Then followed up with Mayuri seeing the stress, and again, I've already spoke about this in one of my videos about that environment, but to see in like 1080p, even though you can actually watch this in 2K, which is great that they actually like animated this in that sort of resolution, is that one thing that I appreciated. Again, we're seeing that even in the backgrounds when Mayuri is walking across the bridge, you get to see so clear that there are people, not only in Karakura Town, so because I want to get to that as well, but there's people actually working in the research development department I couldn't get my words out. That they are all working. They're at the top floors, the third floors, you know, that they're all doing something on the computer. They're all kind of managing something. And you can see them and they're there and you can see the interaction on the screens in front of them as well as the screens in front of Mayuri as well. So all these things that are happening in the background are living and breathing. And that's one thing that you can always appreciate when you go back to that Bleach episode, is that you always notice a little bit of detail. And that is something to kind of appreciate, and that's what gives this series a bit of life. So before we get into some kind of memery, let's talk about the introduction. So of course we have Shino and Yuki becoming the new patrol officers of Karakura Town, which is a bit silly, but again, it's a great way to set up the stage. And again, I will say that the director Taguchi in one of the Weekly Shonen Jump magazines did say that these two characters are great, not only to set the scene of the severity of these new hollows, but also the fact of it's giving you the perception of you are them, like the audience is these characters, right? You are thrown into a world, you don't know why you're there, you heard that there's a substitute shinigami that does this anyway, so why are you here? And then of course you're thrown into like this scary situation with the hollows, which bravo for making the hollows actually look menacing in comparison to before, where they really kind of didn't. And then as soon as Ichigo comes in, the hero that the Soul Society have heard of, it really brings you, as a person that was a fan of it 10 years ago or even recently, feel nostalgic. This is the person that we've been waiting to see. And then the music drops in at the perfect time, being number one by Hazel Fernandez. So with that being said, let's talk about Chad. Because everyone, we all know Chad to a certain degree. Chad is a guy that doesn't use his fists to hurt anybody unless it's to protect somebody. Now the irony here with Chad and why people call him a murderer is because he punched a bunch of hollows that Orihime perfectly set up for Chad to punch. You know, she grouped up about four hollows and then Chad punched them out the way and killed them. However, he punched them into a building, creating a big school, you know, attack that we all love to see. However, in the interim of doing that, killed at least about seven families while doing so, because we get to see, and again, the attention to detail, you can see in high definition people living in the apartments of which he punched these hollows into. To elaborate on why I don't think that this is actually that big of a problem is because we have seen, believe it or not, Orihime being able to revert space and time or heal not only objects but also humans as well. And we also know that the Soul Society are also able to replace people's memories, because we see it with very early on in Bleach. You get to see Rukia do one of those chappy things in front of Orihime once the whole Sora arc had happened and she forgot, lost her memories in like Ichigo and all that sort of stuff. Hopefully she knows now, which I believe she does, because she recalled it back to Grimmjow versus Ichigo. But still, they have tools to kind of wipe people's memories or replace them to a certain extent. And we know that Orihime can fix buildings or objects and or reverse people from dying, as we've seen from Melanie from the Arankar arc. So even though that probably isn't the case of what happened at all, because of course this was in canon filler and very good in canon filler at that, but these are things that Orihime can in fact do. So it is plausible to think that maybe Chad wasn't worrying about the ramifications of his actions, because they can be essentially reversed. Maybe it's a bit of a cop-out, but it makes sense. Why would Chad do something that goes against his own morals if in fact Orihime couldn't deal with the aftermath afterwards? And even so, I don't even think Chad like killed them, because the school itself didn't even penetrate through the building. It just like hit the building enough to like crack the walls and turn off the apartment building's lights, because I was even looking at the image and didn't even look like it even penetrated through the windows. And even if it did, it probably just shattered the window. So I don't even think it killed anybody. It just really damaged the building. So maybe I'm trying to justify Chad's actions here, but they do make sense to some degree. I don't think it's out of character for him to do that, because it would just get fixed anyway. So it's in canon filler. Let the director flex his pen a little bit, right? Which again, that most of that scene with Ichigo doing the Bankai form was by Yamashita a great animator that primarily worked on the Boruto, sorry, the Naruto series. I apologize, Naruto fans, that was really mean to say that. And I did think it was silly that Ichigo did have to go Bankai against all of those hollows. But again, if the studio want to flex, then let them flex, because that's one of the most talked scenes throughout this entire episode, amongst a few other things as well. But again, everybody loves that scene, and clearly was a great choice to incorporate it. Did he need to go Bankai? Absolutely not. Was it fan service? Yes, it was. Do we appreciate it? Absolutely. So regardless of talking about all that as well, there is one issue that I did have with this scene. A few characters weren't on model every now and then. More particularly, there's two frames actually in this whole series that I didn't really like in terms of model. That's the model towards the end, which is of Yuha Ba, which is him sitting on the chair. Hope that gets a little bit altered later on down the road. And the ones of the gang, and I'll show the manga panel in comparison. And BBS did it correct as well. So I was a little bit disappointed that this shot that you see on screen right now didn't really look up to par, nor was it as badass. But apart from that, you know, the rest of the camera angles, especially when the, like, a drone type thing going around the skyscraper with all the hollows climbing up the wall, that was a badass moment. I liked that a lot. I'm pretty sure there was a Menos Grande on there too, and we didn't get to see that Menos Grande ever again. I have to look back at that as I'm editing this video, so I might have made a mistake, but I'm pretty sure there was a Menos Grande up there and we didn't see it. And I'm a bit disappointed. I enjoyed scenes such as them obviously in the bedroom, a little bit of Orihime and Ichigo flirting, which is greatly appreciated and probably going to piss off a few people, but it was nice. It was a nice little dynamic. The one thing I do have a problem with is that they did cut out some scenes, and the only reason why I'm bringing this up now is because, again, they also did get rid of the Hiyori and Lisa scene, though that was taken in the daytime, and they got rid of Yuzu and Karin as well. I don't really mind these changes, because these changes seem to be that this episode is focusing on Ichigo and the gang. That was the main focus, and setting up for the conflict that was to come. So is Yuzu and Karin, or is Hiyori and Lisa relevant at this point? No. They're little changes that can be fixed later on down the road. I mean, the Yuzu and Karin thing, it's whatever. The Hiyori and Lisa can maybe get called back later on. It's possible. I'm okay with it. But for now, these are little changes I don't mind. There's also another little change as well in regards to Ichigo using the Shinigami pass in the manga, and you get to see his soul come out of his body after he kicked Iburn, by the way. Which, again, there's a bit of a comedic scene there with Chad and Uryu and Ichigo, of course. Again, maybe wouldn't have fit the scene, right? Maybe. I understand Taguchi wants to go for a very serious impact here. And again, it follows up both altercations, or both scenarios don't take away from each other, so I'm not extremely stressed by that. I would have liked to have seen him come out of his body into his soul reperform, but again, it wasn't that big of a deal. I could go nor here nor there with it. But yeah, I like the interactions within Ichigo's rooms, and if you didn't notice, Ichigo's apparently got the Yeezy Octobers, the Red Octobers, in his room. It was apparently a big deal on Twitter. I don't know why, but Kubo does know his fashion, so maybe he threw that in there. And also, a little Easter egg as well is that on the wall of Ichigo's room, you get to see Tai Kubo's signature on the wall, the author of Bleach's signature on the wall. So that was a nice little touch as well. Maybe Ichigo's a fan. Breaking the fourth wall? Who knows? We then get into two major fights of this episode. And it's really interesting because this episode is dealing with so many scenarios at the same present time. And that can be handled really good or really bad. And in this case, it was done really well because it really made sure to let you know that these things are happening at the same time, which is a fantastic thing. If I remember in the manga correctly, you had to wait a week and then kind of figure out, okay, this is happening at the same time. But one chapter, you'll get Yamamoto and the Soul Society. Another one, you'd get Ichigo again. So, like, you can kind of get skewed a little bit from it, but this kept reverting back and forth, which is good. But another criticism I also want to add, and that's getting into this next part with Yamamoto and the Sturmritters, who came in and told him that they're going to declare war, which is amazing, of course. Chojuro, Sasakibe, he got a bit done goofed again. I don't think Kubo likes Sasakibe. I think that's just how it is, and we just have to accept that fact that Sasakibe will forever be one of the biggest L's amongst the squads. But I will say, a few of my friends did say that Yamamoto didn't really show emotion until Sasakibe's last breath, which is a little bit incorrect, because we get to see that he is the only person that recognizes Chojuro use his Bankai with the lightning effect that happened, which was a nice little attention to detail. Then right after that, seeing Sasukibe get impaled by that shot goes to show that Yamamoto wasn't happy. I think this is for the first time, the actual first time throughout any of the series and any of the manga, that you see Yamamoto actively flash step and then hold Sasukibe and then put him on the floor gently. Like, he didn't let him fall, he didn't just leave him there to hang and then attack the samurai. Like, no, he went to himself and grabbed him, made contact himself, and showed some kind of compassion, which I don't think we've ever seen that. I think the last time we may have seen that was maybe with Shinji and Hiyori. That's from the top of my head. There's probably some more. But even so, Yamamoto is a stern guy, and I saw emotion through this. I generally did. He looked shocked when Sasukibe got impaled, and then you could see the anger of which was created by the Stone Ritters when he went to go throw that fire blast, to which I liked. I do agree with one of my friends as well, where they said they wish we saw a unsheathing of the sword, but considering how quick Yamamoto is pulling off this attack, I think doing it like an instantaneous fire blast was completely fine as well. Now, the criticism. I wasn't a fan of the flash step. We've all been used to how the flash step has looked before, and I'm going to reserve my thoughts on this specific flash step on its own, because I want to see the other Soul Reapers' flash steps first before I comment, because maybe that this was a purposeful change, but if this is a common change, then I have to see how it works in other situations. Because in this cut, in this shot, wasn't a fan of the flash step. I just wasn't. It wasn't hitting for me, though I'm going to give it the benefit of the doubt for now to see if this changes or if this was just a one-off. Because if it is the same, then how does it look in other fights and other situations? Because I might end up liking it, depending, because it is different. So I am going to pend that criticism for now. Following through with that though, I will say the Ichigo versus Iben fight was absolutely awesome. I love the choreography. I love how they flew under the bridge where Shuhei Isage fought Findor back in the fake Karakura Town War arc. Little nod to that too, which you probably wouldn't have noticed until you heard this review. That was really nice. But again, the choreography of them two fighting was really nice. I also love, again, that probably nobody really cares about, is that Kubo, and I'll show it on screen as well, that Kubo, when he does a blast or an explosion or even an energy ball, there's this like effect that he does with like a black pen where it's kind of wavy, and they keep that sentiment throughout the anime as well, which is great attention to detail, because if they wanted to, they could have just done a big blue ball of energy and just fired it. But no, they kept it like the Kubo style, and I've been noticing that as well with their smoke effects as well. Kubo has a certain effect with smoke as well, and they keep that. So the effects direction team is amazing for that as well, and kudos to them for really implementing that art style. Other than that, I've enjoyed the effects. I don't think it's too shiny anymore. I don't think it's too much in terms of the effects. I think it's grown on me. There, of course, are some panels in the manga that are better than the anime itself, but again, there's some shots in the anime that are better than the manga itself as well. So again, you're not always going to win. It's not always going to be one for one, but their interpretation has been pretty good so far, especially with adding a lot of detail and adding a lot of fights or adding a lot of choreography to these fights as well. For example, there is like one shot where Ichigo like slices an energy blast and it splits into two ways, while in the manga it seems like Ichigo kind of just like parries it and it just like there's a big wall of explosion behind him, which I think I prefer, but I don't hate the anime version. It works as well, to which then Ichigo goes Bankai, they try and steal the Bankai, and at the same time there's a great suspense here because Sasukibe is like on his last breaths, and I love that his pupils are absolutely gone as well. And again, maybe it's me, but you already know by this time that he is completely not unconscious, but he's blacked out. Like his vision is completely gone, and he's literally saying his last breaths and throwing the pupils away and seeing the blood dripping from him. You get a real sense of like he is literally struggling to say this, and it doesn't feel fake like I've seen with some animators, right? So the character acting for the only voice actor that's going to have like the least amount of lines in this series, he did a good job. He really put his heart and soul into it. Might I add again, the embers burning in the Division 1 barracks, beautiful. That's like one of the best scenes that I just love that, because you get to see the Soul Society at the bottom, you see these embers and the scorchiness. whoever painted that is insane. I love that shot. It's great. But yeah, Sasakibe really was like a linchpin of sorts to really kind of give you that this is serious. I mean, it's Sasakibe of all things, but still, he was a lieutenant. So to get bodied that quickly, even though we don't really know much about Sasakibe, goes to show the perfection of Kubo's is show but don't tell. Because if Yamamoto is showing this much respect to Sasakibe, and he is a lieutenant, even though we don't get to see much, we know he's powerful based on how characters interact with him and the respect that characters give him. So yeah, while he may be disappointing to us, Kubo's show and don't tell really hits that these guys are serious. Like, it sets the perfect linchpin to show the tone of this arc. I'm really impressed with how mature Ichigo is and how much more ruthless he is in comparison to the old anime. They give him more of a tough demeanor, which he always had in the manga, but not so much in the anime. I love the effects that they used to try and steal the Bankai. I felt that that was great. I wasn't disappointed with that. The big cross in the back, the glistening of certain items that we use, like the Quincy cross, for example. And also the shadow effect when they go back to the Royal Guard Palace, right? That was such an amazing effect as well. And just that shot of Ichigo's face is just, so good. And then to end the episode, we get to see our Quincy King, Yuhaba, and we get straight off the bat just how ruthless he is and that he shows, you know, no intolerance, so to say. And again, that really sets up our main villain. So the episode does well in demonstrating our villain, does great with the pacing, does well with the fight choreography, does well quite a lot of things in this episode. Direction was great, showing the backgrounds to elude danger was fantastic, and using kind of no-name characters, giving them a purpose in terms of using them as the audience's POV, so to say. In terms of the music, this is music that we have heard from the short trailers that we've heard, and to be honest, fantastic. Sagasu hits again. I have nothing to say bad once about the music, and it's actually, it fits in the moments that it needs to fit. There's probably so much more I want to say about this episode. There's always something that I want to say, but I think this is the general rundown of everything important. So that is currently my review of episode 1 of just a great episode to start off with, because you already know if you are a big Bleach fan, it's going to be fight after fight after fight after fight. I think that this is a perfect episode to really draw the masses in. If a first episode is supposed to give an insight into gathering an audience, this was the episode to do it. This was the episode to really set a stage of like, this is what Bleach is and this is what it's going to be without like diminishing from here. So it was a great first episode, and I already know that this isn't the best that they can do, and that's the crazy thing. So that being said, I hope you enjoyed the video. Please like and subscribe to get more up to date on more reviews like this. If you enjoy them, please tell me in the comment section down below. That being said, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. I've been Hanson, and as always, people, peace out.